Welcome everyone, once again, to the ordeal of preparation. And keep in mind, we either do this ordeal or we do the ordeal of going along with the kingdom of the flesh. And that's just a perpetual ordeal with no escape, no benefit from it actually, from going that direction. It's a dead end. It's a dead end. So we do this ordeal of preparation even though the ego says it doesn't work. There's no use. You haven't succeeded yet. Therefore, you can never succeed. This is, you know, this is the illogic of the kingdom of the flesh. Of the flesh. The flesh is nothing but a liar. I've seen that today. All the lies that the flesh engages in, it's just unbelievable. The kind of lies that it's nothing but a liar. And what lies do is they extend themselves as more and more lies, more and more lies. The kingdom of the flesh, the economy of the flesh. Exchange that for the economy of grace. This is what I saw today that has to happen. In the economy of the flesh, I've seen for somehow I've been trapped in this economy of the flesh. And it's because of its very tricky lies, very tricky lies. And here's an example of something. I was in this long line today in my truck. Really long, it's gonna be a long wait. And then I realized, hey, wait a minute, I have a... the cat's going up the tree again. I have a commercial account. I don't have to wait in this line. I can go over to the line where there's nobody at all. But I've been waiting in line for quite some time. And all these trucks in front of me, behind me, and everybody's just all, you know, upset, like, wow, it's gonna take for so long to get through, so long. I said, well, I don't have to wait in this line. And then I thought, well, yeah, but if I like pull out, then everybody's gonna think like, who does he think he is, you know? And you know, does he think he's special and important? Why does he have to not wait in line? And then they'd made some changes to the lane that I had to go to. And I thought, maybe it's a different policy because I don't see any trucks going there. But I said, you know what? I thought about it, went back and forth. I said, you know what? It's just spiritually, there's some sort of spiritual lesson here. I have the account. I have the right to go to the other lane, for sure. Doesn't matter if I've been waiting in this one. Maybe I just had forgotten this or something. So let me give it a try. Now, when I get up there, I'm worried, like, if they say, oh, no, we've changed our policy or something, then I'd have to go, like, all the way back down to the very end of the line again. Nobody's going to let me in, you see. Well, I got up there, I know the people, I have, you know, very good standing with everybody, and they're very nice to me. And just, no problem, go right through, that's it. And sorry for the wait, they say. It's like, worked like a charm, you know, it's like, wow. And this, I realized this has a spiritual lesson here. As we wait in the kingdom of flesh for the never to appear benefits, actually. We all have an account of grace. We all have an account of grace. We can all get in the grace economy, the economy of grace, which works very different than the economy of the flesh. And the economy of the flesh lies about the economy of grace ceaselessly, saying how no, if it doesn't work, you're going to have to go to the very bottom, back, you have to go to the end of the line in the flesh and start all over again. This, I realize these are the lies that we're told. This is why I'm so much against karma. I'm so much against the evolution of consciousness. I'm so much, for me, these are lies that the economy of the flesh is telling us. And they say, hey, if we accept grace and suddenly find ourselves in the economy of grace, which says you don't need this. Economy of grace is all about this growing realization that you don't need this suffering. You don't need this delay. You don't need this time. You don't need this feeling of time, this feeling of space. You don't need suffering, you don't need misery, you don't need despair, you don't need loneliness, you don't need unhappiness, you don't need sickness, you don't need aging, you don't even need a body, you don't even need a world. You know, on and on and on and on and on and on and on. That's the economy, that you don't need repercussions. You don't need, like, you know, lessons of consciousness where you learn from dying a million times and running into terrible problems constantly and having to try to solve those problems and getting more and more smart, you know, how to avoid getting killed and stuff. You don't need that at all. No one does. That's the economy of grace. So the economy of grace frees us from the economy of the flesh. And the economy of the flesh says, hey, no. What if you fail? You have to go all the way back to the beginning of the economy of flesh, go through the whole thing again. And of course, that terrifies us, absolutely terrifies us. It's a lie. Or you'll be rejected by the, or you have to wait. You got all this karma. You don't have grace. You know, you got to be saved through works. And you can't go into that lane. You have to wait. Duration, space, time, space, duration. All lies. But it's no, but you know, it's very difficult to pull out of this line of economy of the flesh and just go straight to grace. And grace waves you through, says, welcome. We've been waiting for you. Who's going to do that? Because of the threat is so severe that the flesh makes. Well, I decided to do it at least symbolically today. And I'm gearing up. I'm trying to, it shows you that I've got it in within me to say, you know, no, I'm going to take the risk. Salvation is through grace, not through works. That is a fact. We all have an account in grace. We all have an account so we can go to the grace economy and get waved right through. No waiting at all, actually. No waiting at all. Everyone. It's just we are... Our continuity of fear blinds us to this. So what the spiritual, what the ordeal of preparation does is it helps evaporate our continuity of fear to the extent that we can remember and recognize and act upon the fact that we do have an account with grace, all in good standing, and we can go right on through. All right. Very good. Very good beginning. I have to have some root beer here. It is a summer afternoon after all. Very windy. So we have the first step to this video, is we all have an account of grace. We've talked about how there's two economies. There's the flesh-based economy and the grace-based economy. Flesh-based economy, of course, we're all very familiar with. This is what we've been living for so long. The grace-based economy we're not so familiar with. It's called miracles. Miracles are just simply time-saving situations where you realize, hey, I don't really need this. Ultimately, we'll get to the point and say, I don't really need another body. I don't really need to come into the world. I don't really need, and on and on and on and on. Eventually, it'll be, hey, I don't even need any form. You know, I don't need... objectivity, anything that's objectified. You know, I am the totality. I am spirit. I am free. I'm not a body. I am spirit. I am free. I'm exactly as God created me. I'm still exactly as God created me. Ultimately, miracles bring us to that. But we can start experiencing miracles right here, right now, in this world. And I just had amazing experiences today that helped highlight this, how the flesh is so sure it's the way, and so sure it knows everything, and so sure it knows all the answers, and so sure it knows all about grace, so sure it knows all about everything. It's all lying and bluffing. It's lying and bluffing, and we have to say no to that. Lies have to stop somewhere, and it starts with our saying no. See, lies think that by extending themselves, they become true. Lies believe that by extending themselves, they become true. But lies just simply double down. They don't become true. Lies never become true. And so you have to say now, no, right now. When does a lie come to an end? Right now. Not through extension in time and space. It doesn't come to an end. Like you say, I want lies to come to the end. Lies will say, oh, okay. We'll just extend ourselves, that'll come to an end. No, that'll just keep going. All lies come to an end right here, right now. When we stop the extension of a lie, that's when it ends. So it has to end here, it has to end now. Always, all lives have to end here and now. And this is something we have to do to get through. And I had several situations today, the flesh would not take no for an answer, didn't want to. And they kept saying, well, I can do that, or you want this. I said, no, I'm not in the vicinity here. No, I can go anywhere you want, meaning, whatever you want, lies, the flesh says, whatever you want or need, I can do it. That's a lie. That's a lie. It cannot carry out the kind of miracles that Holy Spirit can carry out. Lies cannot, the flesh cannot. And the flesh tells us that when we start getting these miracles from the Holy Spirit, and there doesn't seem to be any repercussions in this world, the flesh is, well, that's great, you know, I could like become like super powerful in this world. I just had that ability. And it tries to transfer this into psychic powers, the miracles of the Holy Spirit. It tries to think, well, this is just kind of some kind of psychic power. Somehow you're orchestrating things to escape punishment here in this world. And then it can develop into, grandiosity, criminality. The flesh thinks, oh, this is great. I can just completely get my own kingdom and be all powerful in it. That's how the flesh sees it. And so there is that trouble or temptation as you go along with grace to think like, wow, I'm living a charmed existence, and the flesh says, hey, I'll tell you what, let's make a deal. We'll put you as the on the throne of the universe, and we'll worship you. But of course they're saying, we're going to study you and try to figure out, how are you avoiding the repercussions? That's what the flesh wants to do. Of course, the flesh wants to avoid the repercussions of all its actions here. Which it doesn't, it cannot. Perfect storms always are arising. Perfect storms are always arising. And the flesh says, well, if it weren't for a perfect storm, it wouldn't have suffered any repercussions. Well, perfect storms are constantly arising here. So, to think that if you believe in good karma, you got to believe in bad karma, and think you can always stay on the good side of good karma is not true. You're going to get, the perfect storm is going to pull you down. And then the flesh will say, blame it on the perfect storm and say, well, I would have been okay if not for that. That's not grace. It's a tremendous battle here between us. We think, hey, if I could just harness this ability of somehow living a charmed life, I could, be a great figurehead for the world or something. But now keep this in mind, that when you exchange the economy of the flesh for the economy of grace, it's up to grace to how to deploy you. You're now part of that economy, and that economy has its own intelligence. That cat is way up there now. In the economy of the flesh, of course, you're supposed to like fight and battle and get as much as you can and be really clever and smart and faster and make deals and break deals and use the laws, leverage, and just so many, many things, right? And you're entitled to all sorts of perks, and stuff gets taken away, but you can battle back. It's just this horrible, horrible struggle. That's the economy of the flesh. And you seem free there. It's like, hey, you can rise to any heights you want to, if you choose to be vicious enough. It seems that way. It doesn't always work out that way by any means. But the flesh is actually deploying you, showing you what you can do, what the rules are, and all this stuff. Well, when we, in the economy of grace, grace decides how to deploy us, where to go, who to talk to, what to do. And so you may not be free to say, well, hey, I want to be seen in this light, or I want to talk to those people, or I want to do this or that. That's not part of the economy of grace. The grace is there to save everybody time. So you have to go along with the program. That is what I'm seeing. You have to go along with the program. and just trust that this economy is all working for the good of all, you know, and just and say okay, and we're heartened by the fact that the quote unquote very lowest in the economy of grace is higher than the very highest in the economy of the flesh. The very lowest, right? It's higher than the highest in the economy of flesh. And you can't even, in the economy of grace, this is not about status. It's not about status. It's about progressively recognizing, I don't need this, I don't need that. And so you may not have any, who's to say what kind of role you play to the economy of the flesh, what kind of liaison you will be. Maybe you won't even have anything to do with it. It's up to the Holy Spirit, really, is how I'm seeing it. I had a dream last night about that, and it's very interesting. I had a very interesting dream sequence last night, where I was just getting the non-dual abidance, and then just kind of easing into it, and kind of not backing off so much, but it was just amazing how I sort of was getting into the non-dual abidance, and really getting it, and actually doing it in the dream. So this is all oncoming. And I saw somebody in like a yearbook, in a picture of somebody, and it said this one was like very, very, very highly placed, very, very successful or something. I said, I've never heard of him. The way the Holy Spirit works, the economy of grace, we don't necessarily know here in the economy of the flesh who's doing what. We're not privy to that information. And of course, the economy of flesh says, look, we can help you out. Just tell us all what you're doing and we'll help you out. No, the economy of flesh is based on lies and deceit, 100%. And it cannot help out. It cannot help grace out. The flesh, the reasoning, the false reasoning of the flesh cannot help out grace at all. So it doesn't help the economy of the flesh to know anything about that, what's going on. It's only on a need-to-know basis in terms of how it does evaporate our continuity fear. So there may be a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes that we don't know about at all. And so we don't really know who's doing what in terms of helping out with miracles and all that. You know, so even if we start at the bottom of the economy of grace, we're higher than the highest position in the economy of flesh. Our feeling is way higher than any feeling that the economy of flesh can ever bring. Way, apples and oranges, night and day above it, night and day above it. Because we don't no longer have the feeling of time-space, feeling of time, feeling of duration, and feeling of distance, distance, duration, no longer the feeling. No longer have the feeling of despair, unhappiness, loneliness. No longer have any of those feelings of fatigue, sickness. Those are all feelings, actually. The way that we feel is a feeling, and I've noticed you go through life, and nothing changes this feeling. So if it was really based on what's outside, don't you think that the feeling would be changing? It doesn't. It doesn't. My feeling has not changed. The fundamental feeling I have, one of fear, has not changed at all, no matter what happens externally. It just shows you it's actually the feeling comes first. The feeling comes first, and then externally we give a screen to project it upon. And then we blame it upon what's projected on the screen. We think that's the cause of it. You see, we misunderstand the causation of what we're feeling. So when we go over the economy of grace, we don't have any more of those bad feelings. It's all good. It's all good. And from that standpoint, it's just, you know, how are you deployed? Well, let the Holy Spirit determine that. It knows exactly how to effectively deploy everyone. And so I'm trying to get to accept this. I'm trying to get this to accept and actually, you know, make the exchange. I need to, because the economy of the flesh is actually causing me extreme troubles right now. Extreme troubles. So it really is time to go to the economy of grace, which will certainly bring about the feeling, I don't need this. I don't need troubles. See, I don't need troubles. economy of flesh always tells us that we grow by getting troubles and difficulties and problems, and then fishes this hardly. Nobody questions it. But I certainly have. I've certainly questioned this. It doesn't really add up very well at all. And it certainly hasn't played out in my life properly. Now, the way that one has to deal with the economy of the flesh, the ego, is to say that you don't need it anymore, and that's it. Nothing more than that. You don't need it anymore. It's the only way. You can never get the ego to agree that, okay, reasonably say, okay, I understand why you're doing this. Lies can never understand truth. Lies cannot understand that time is only a feeling we don't need, that space is only a feeling we don't need. Lies are all based on fear, the continuity fear. And being based on fear, it's not rational at all. It's defensive. Okay? The economy of the flesh, the ego, is totally defensive. It believes there's something to defend against. So if you say there's nothing to defend against, they'll never agree with that. Never agree with that. And so they'll always argue about what kind of deal needs to be made. You're shuffling one defense for some other defense. You don't like that defense? Okay, here's another one. It's always about that. So you just have to simply say, I don't need that anymore. Don't need the kingdom of the flesh anymore at all. The economy of the flesh. Don't need it. I'm exchanging it. And don't try to resolve anything with the ego at all. This is why the practice of no teacher, no student is so important. This is what really fries the ego and gets us ready for making an exchange and actually living in the economy of grace, actually living in that. Being an inhabitant of the kingdom of grace is this practice of no teaching, no teacher, no student. Because somehow each one of us has to have the courage to get out of that long line, that endless line we're in. We're in this endless line. Everybody's in the line, we're waiting. Yeah, well, it's a long wait, but eventually we'll get there. Well, no one's ever got there waiting in that line. And of course, we hear stories that somebody got there. Not true. The line of lies never reaches truth, never reaches happiness, never reaches freedom from fear. Never. Fear never reaches freedom from fear. It's spirit that has to say, I don't need fear anymore. I was the one who has brought forth fear, this feeling of fear, of distance, duration, time, space, unhappiness. I'm the one who's decided to feel these feelings. They weren't forced upon me at all. It was directly because I wanted to, a desire to be greater than God, and tried to objectify God, that God is an object, is freedom as an object. Pure freedom as an object that gave rise to this experience of complete chaoticness. I'm trying to avoid getting hit by that too much. And so we're entirely responsible for it. It didn't come to us from outside of us at all. That's the delusion. So when we say, I don't need it anymore, means I've understood it doesn't come from outside of me at all. So the whole economy of the flesh is the belief it's coming, the problems are coming from outside of us, and that we can battle against those problems and be clever and ingenious and overcome these problems through using the energy of God, using all these forces, instead of recognition, instead of grace. Grace helps us realize we don't need it. We don't need any of this belief of anything outside of us at all. There's nothing outside of us at all. And Grace will help us realize this. The economy of flesh will never help us realize this. It will lead us away from that. It will lead us away from that to an extraordinary extent, which is what it's doing as much as possible now. It's always doing as much as possible. It just now is a lot more as possible with the technology that the planet has right now. So the ordeal of preparation is to get us to say, I'm switching over to grace. I don't need the economy of the flesh. I don't need the economy of the flesh. All I need is to evaporate the continuity fear. There's nothing outside of me. I'm only clinging to the belief system out of fear, a continuity fear of like, wow, I'm not quite ready for pure happiness yet. And the economy of grace understands that. And so it gradually helps us realize more and more and more, I don't need this, I don't need this, I don't need this, I don't need this. Don't need this form of fear, don't need this form of fear, don't need this form of fear. And until eventually it says, I don't need fear at all. Eventually it will say, I don't need fear at all. We'll realize that we don't need fear at all eventually. So we have to do this preparation so we can get out of the line we've been in, this long, endless line. And everybody's saying, wow, we're trying to be as good as, you know, patient as possible in this long line. We all gotta wait our time here. All gotta wait our time. And somebody pulls out, goes up to the checkpoint, get waved right through. They say, what? You know, how did they manage? Well, there may be like a little checkpoint there off to the side, and nobody's in that line at all. So everybody assumes, no, we have to be in this endless line. We can't see our checkpoint yet. And then someone goes to this checkpoint, and they get waved right through, and they say, wow, I wonder where they're going. Can't be a good place, can it? Only those who wait in this endless line can possibly have anything good happen to them. Let me see if I can boost this. It's the light is really... So there's this mythology, this lie, that only those who wait in this long line can ever have anything good happen to them. The ones who go to this grace checkpoint of grace and just get waved through, they say, well, they must be going to hell. Because that makes them who are waiting in line feel good about themselves, right? Righteous about themselves. Say, yeah, I'm waiting in line for a purpose here. I'm going to learn how to defeat the enemy. I'm going to learn how to overcome the problems of the forces and nature. I'm going to try to, you know, do that. And so they say that, well, the person who gets out of line must be going to hell or something like that. Whatever it is, it has to be terrible. Otherwise, they would do it too, right? But they're too afraid to do it. You see, this is the whole problem with not recognizing the continuity fear, is you end up developing this whole massive belief system of rationalizations for your decisions that does not include the continuity fear. So, for instance, you're in this long line, endless line. There's a great line of grace that you can just wave right through. But you're too afraid because of the continuity fear to get out of line, okay? Now, if you don't recognize a continuity fear, you're going to say, no, I'm not. The reason why I'm not getting out of line here is because I know that other line takes them straight to hell. Most definitely must go straight to hell. And then they have to start, I'll go all the way back and start beginning the line, or they're completely destroyed. That's why I'm not getting out of line. You see, this is a rationalization. This is sour grapes rationalization. But if you recognize I have a severe continuity fear, say, you'd say the reason I'm not getting out of this line is because I have a severe continuity fear. And I'm afraid of heaven. I'm afraid of the kingdom of grace. I'm afraid of pure happiness. That's the only reason I'm not getting out of the line. You know, all this other stuff is nonsense. You see what a powerful position that puts you in. Because then you start thinking intelligently, reasonably. And you're saying, well, I mean, what's the worst that really could happen to me? I have to go all the way back to the end of this line. But I don't think that that's likely to happen. Let me shift. Can I shift over here? I can get to go right in the middle. I very much doubt that's going to happen. And so you start making your decision is based on intelligence instead of rationalization. And you work on your continuity fear so you get less and less fear. And finally, you can pull out of that line. Otherwise, you will stay in the line and rationalize, and you'll talk to the other people in the line and say, hey, what do you think about that person that went out there? And they said, oh, terrible person, idiot, what an idiot, what a fool. They're just going to be annihilated, or terrible, terrible stuff's going to happen to them. Well, they're going to have to go all the way to the end of the line. So everybody in the line agrees, you know, oh, this is awful. That's the problem of waiting in this line of lies, the line of lies, is you end up rationalizing it. Everybody wants to rationalize, you know, that we're doing this for a great purpose. We're suffering for a great purpose. We're miserable for something very important. This line is going to pay off just wonderfully. See, it doesn't. It never pays off. It's based on actually trying to escape the experiencing. Escape experiencing, period. Because we think that the experiencing of the totality is one of total chaos. So what we're trying to do is we're really trying to escape experiencing. And we do that by trying to put it into experience, which is images. This was an experience I had. This is another experience I had. Categorize them, arrange them, structure them. All of this stuff we're trying to do. We're trying to ultimately reach oblivion to experiencing. As if we can take all the chaoticness of experiencing, the attempt to objectify totality, and make all frame snapshots of pieces of it, and then structure the pieces in ways that we feel we're in control. We can structure it how we want to, and make it pleasing to us, the structure of all these images. This is what this long line is for. As we're in this long line, people say, oh, we might as well stay busy, so let's figure out let's see if we can, you know, arrange these images this way and arrange these images that way and make it all seem wonderful. We can never be happy with experiences. We can only be happy with experiencing. Then there's a big difference between the two, for sure. Experiencing is here now. Experiences are in the past. They're objectified. Keep in mind that time is a desire for objectification. You're here now. The experience is in the past, right? So you're like in the future of that past. You're greater than that, you see. This is a way of symbolizing the desire to be greater than God. So we've objectified the past. It's not here now. This is an experience that was, you know, long ago. We're looking at it now. So you could say that time is a symbol of objectification. And then you have these memories of the past, images of experience, thoughts or images of an experience that you had, that you no longer have, and can no longer have, and it's it's objectification. Objectification means I'm here, and this is over there, and that's over there. This isn't here, it's over there. Whereas totality is that everything is here. There's only one all-inclusive here-ness. This is the feeling. There's just one all-inclusive here-ness, and this is that feeling is so much better than objectification. I am here. That is there. Here and there. All one all-inclusive here-ness is the vision of oneness, and that brings us just this wonderful feeling. Opposite of fear, a feeling of love. Whereas the feeling we have now is the feeling of fear. Feeling of fear. And no matter what we do with images and memories and thoughts and objectification, it's always still the same feeling of fear that we have. We always just live with this feeling of fear. And we try to, paper it over. It's like a house and the foundation is ready to collapse and you're repainting the house, putting new wallpaper up, trying to feel better about your situation. It's this time of the year where the sun starts getting through here like this. I'll have to do something about that. In the summer it's over centrally, it's getting blocked, but now it's getting through. The cat is just living up in the tree now, way up in the tree. Oh my gosh, it's just sleeping up there, kind of. Up there with the birds. So we're covering some incredibly fertile, helpful territory right here, and we always try to. And of course, the flesh says, "Let me help out. Let me categorize it. Let me arrange it." Like, no! Don't let the flesh help out. Do not let the flesh help out. The flesh thinks it's co-redeemer. It is not co-redeemer at all. The flesh thinks that it has to be integrated. No, it doesn't. Nothing needs to be integrated. Polarization is not the polarization between truth and lies at all. That's not polarization. Truth is true and nothing else is true. There's no opposite to truth. All polarizations is within lies. So you don't have to integrate polar opposites within lies at all. You don't have to do anything. You said, I don't need lies. I don't need the kingdom of lies. I don't have to do anything with the kingdom of lies. The economy of lies. So ultimately, what we're going for is this here-ness. Now, that shuts out the flesh entirely, actually. It shuts it out. You realize there's no need for it anymore. Ultimately, there's no need for bodies, but certainly there's no need for the advice of the flesh. You go into the economy of grace then, when there all is equal here-ness. Then, simply, you are used as a prop to help others recognize this and accept it. It's already the case for you. It's already the case. You don't have to earn it. It's a fact right now. Just when we drop our attempt to subject-object, objectify, that's what we tried to do with God, is objectify God, objectify totality, objectify freedom, objectify pure freedom. How can pure freedom be an object? Of what? How can we objectify it? How can we objectify we that are pure freedom? Now you can say that pure spaciousness could objectify everything, but we didn't create pure spaciousness. We were created as pure freedom. And we cannot turn pure spaciousness into an object. How do we objectify pure spaciousness? Okay. And freedom and pure spaciousness are one functioning of reality. How do we objectify pure spaciousness? How is that possible? Wherever we are, we're in pure spaciousness, completely inclusive, all included in pure spaciousness. So how can we objectify that? We cannot. Oh, let's see what that cat's doing. I mean, Is it just sleeping up there or what? I don't know. Ah, forget it. Forget it. It's not important. We have to forget the world. What it's doing is not important. The dance of objectification is not important. There is no right now. Okay? There's nothing that needs to happen in order for everything to be here right now. The total here-ness, there's nothing that has to happen. The total here-ness is always present. Perfectly present. The total here-ness is always perfectly present. The total here-ness is always perfectly present. I think that cat actually was a squirrel in a previous life, and it's just trying to remember how to be like a squirrel, actually. It's up there with the squirrels, watching the squirrels. Loves to watch the squirrels. Acts like a squirrel in the tree. It jumps from limb to limb like a squirrel. I really think it, in the past life it was a squirrel. It's a very squirrely cat, too, actually. It runs like a, dashes like a squirrel, leaps like a squirrel. Maybe it just likes walnuts. Maybe it's gone up there to get some walnuts. That's possible too. I don't know. That's crazy. Now the squirrel's yelling at it. Get out of here. It's my tree. So there's non-dual abidance, non-dual abidance in the non-dual absolute, abidance in the non-dual absolute. It's right here. And the dream is just like I was sort of floating in and out of it, sort of just kind of trying it on for size, so to speak. It simply is the total here-ness, the here-ness of totality. The total here-ness of everything is totally in relation to the pure spaciousness. Everything in relation to pure spaciousness is equally totally here now. And this is the feeling that needs to be primary, is not what is everything in relationship to this body, but what is everything in relationship to pure spaciousness? What is the feeling that everything is having in relationship to pure spaciousness? Ask to experience that feeling instead of some personal feeling. We call nirvana impersonal. What it means is that it's what is the feeling that everything has in relation to pure spaciousness? What is that feeling? Let's experience that feeling. Some call it awareness. Some call it feeling, that feeling. What is that feeling? What does that feel like? Then that gives up the special feeling that we think we're supposed to have as a person. Say, we have a special, we're told, people are special, we're special. We have a different feeling. We have a personal relationship with God. It's something that's different. You know, we're special. Well, that specialness is the feeling of fear, actually. It's the feeling of fear. And we think fear makes us special. But what we're really hiding is we're trying to find a way to get used to fear, to enjoy fear, so that we don't have to deal with the continuity fear. You know, we're unaware we have this continuity fear, so we think we have to somehow get used to this fear. And we think the fear is actually that totality has gone crazy into complete destruction, annihilation, chaos, utter chaos. That's what we believe. not admitting that it was our own attempt to objectify it. So we could say we are greater than it, we're beyond it, that we objectify pure spaciousness and say, oh yeah, pure spaciousness is great, except it's in me. I'm not in it, it's in me, it's an object that I'm experiencing, an object. But what is the experience of all objects in relation to pure spaciousness? Isn't it that everything has the same relationship? Right now we see everything as having different relationships with everything. We don't see everything in God, so to speak, the relationship with God. Everything as God, because it's entirely within God, 100%. We're not feeling that. And so that is the feeling. Vision of Oneness is this feeling. Replacing the feelings of distance and duration and duality of subject-objectness that we have been entertaining as experience, images, experience, as an attempt to flee away from this chaoticness that arises when we try to objectify totality, pure freedom. It appears to us as utter chaos. But actually, that's just our desire becomes utterly chaotic, because there isn't any way to do it. And as long as we hold on to this desire, it'll seem chaotic, so we're not sure where it's failing. It doesn't work, but in total chaos, we say, I have no idea. There's no way to determine why it's failing. I can't determine at all. And that's a way of keeping it, isn't it? But the answer is, it's not failing. It never could succeed in the first place. It's not failing. When we say, huh, I see this total chaos. Oh, wow, it's impossible to determine where the failure is. Yeah, I'm looking to see, where is it failing here? There's no failing. Lies are not failing. Lies are inherent impossibility. You can't even call them a failure, because a failure implies it's possible for success. It's just not succeeding. There's no possibility of success. So there's nothing that one needs to determine about chaos. Or how to say, okay, wow, that initial experience of chaos, I need to a lot of time and space to sort it all out, and let's find out pieces of walnut are dropping on that roof here. Sort it out, and let's find out where's the failure taking place. Where's the failure? There is no failure taking place. There's no possibility of success, so there can't be any failure taking place. Get that? There isn't any possibility of success whatsoever to objectify reality. So there isn't any failure taking place. So all our attempt to sort this out, figure out where's the failure taking place, and in so doing, we're pursuing oblivion, actually. The oblivion of form, and image, and thought, and memory, and past, time, distance, all that stuff. We're trying to get used to this oblivion that we are feeling, really, fear. So there isn't any failure to figure out. We just don't need all this search. We don't need all this economy of the flesh trying to figure out how to find the failure and fix the failure. There is no failure, because there's no possibility of success. How can there be a failure to fix? See, this is non-dual talk. It's different emphasis, isn't it? The more we get used to this different emphasis, the easier it is to, get out of that endless line of lies, go into the economy of grace. and the burdens will be lifted from you. That's what we're told. We don't need to find failure. We don't need to fix failure at all. So we don't need to be involved in any sort of situations of failure at all, because there isn't any success. There's no way to succeed, so failure is meaningless. Failure is only meaningful in terms of something that we can succeed at, and we're just failing to do so. But there isn't any way we can succeed in objectifying reality, totality, except with this total chaos, which is basically denial that there's no way to succeed. You know, because we desire to succeed, that gives us this snapshot of total chaos, which is a way of saying there's failure somewhere. It's just as impossible to determine where it is, and then I need a lot of time and space to sort it out. So that this is how it happens. And if we just say no, there's no failure, no fixing, no failure, no problem, no success, no problem. No failure, no fixes, no success, no problem. And this different emphasis is where it's at. It's where it's at. You're not going to get this from the flesh, are you? You don't get this different emphasis that's just like, whoa, I hadn't thought of that. Or like, wow, that's a way of emphasizing that I hadn't yet, not used to that. I'm not used to it. We may have come across it, you know, at times of inspiration, we suddenly say, you know what, how about emphasizing it this way? And so all that somebody does who has experience with this familiarity is they're good at emphasizing, you know, in a way that helps us a lot. We get used to it. And then we say, oh, it's a piece of cake. Yeah, getting out of that line is no problem. It's easy. There's nothing to find, nothing to fix. Nothing to find and nothing to fix. Nothing to find and nothing to fix. That is true. There's nothing to find, nothing to fix. Everything is here now. There's only total here-ness. Nothing to find, nothing to fix. There's only total, perfect here-ness. All inclusive, equally included in God, pure spaciousness. There's nothing to find and nothing to fix. Nothing to find and nothing to fix. And the Holy Spirit's grace is practical, economy of grace is practical, so it knows that we've made these bodies in this world and to make ourselves feel problems, need to fix it. So it'll just help us out and say, you don't need that problem, you don't need that problem, you don't need to fix this, you don't need to fix that, you don't need to fix it. And our life gets smoothed out somehow, miraculously, without us even thinking about it. That's what we're told. That's what we're told. For some reason, I'm still holding on to some things, as most of us do. So we just have to keep on like this and make the switch over to the whole economy of grace, which is this, you feel the vision of oneness, this total here-ness, total here-ness, just one total here-ness. And I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to that for sure. And you might even say the economy of grace will make sure that we do have enough situations in the world to, so we can remain here and be of help, etc. You can look at it that way. Because ultimately we might say, hey, I don't even need to stay here in the need form at all, actually. The total here-ness of all is once you see it, it's a different ballgame altogether. So We may not be finding problems and fixing problems here. What we're doing is emphasizing there are no problems. There's nothing to fix. There is no success, nothing to succeed at. This whole idea of success is based on the idea of finding a problem and fixing it. That's the economy of the flesh, is the basic premise is that there's a problem, a severe problem. And eventually we'll fix it, but we need a lot of time and space to do that. And a lot of growth and struggling to learn how to cope with survival and all these difficult, this big training program we're on. And then eventually we'll figure out how to solve all the riddles and the problems and the difficulties, etc. There is no problem. There are no problems. There is no difficulty. How could there be? In the here-ness, the one here-ness, the one totality, the one here-ness, there is no problem with that whatsoever. There can never be. Fundamentally, there can never be any problem with reality. In terms of being, there can never be a problem with being. There can never be a problem with being. The one being, it's just the one being. It's the all-inclusive, all, totally inclusive one being. There can never be a problem with that. And so again, hear all this and let it permeate. Don't figure it out. Say that there's no figuring out to be done. Figuring out is trying to figure out where's the problem. There isn't any problem. There's nothing to figure out, actually. Again, we desire to be greater than God. We desire to objectify God. And that desire then appears since we can't do it, what we do is we deny that we can't do it by this vision of total chaos, in which we can claim that it's not that we can't do it, it's that we can't find out where the problem is as to why we can't do it. If we found it, we could fix it. So we think it's just a problem that it's not that we can't do it, it's just that we have a problem doing it. Yet we can't discern where the problem is. So this is a cover-up. It's a cover-up of it's our denial that we can't do it. It's a denial we can't do it. We say, yeah, we can do it. It's just that it seems right now we just can't determine where we need to work on it. Where's the problem? And then we go into this dream of time and space where we pretend to be working on all sorts of problems. The body just has endless problems, doesn't it? And as long as we have this feeling that we're working on problems, we're identifying problems, we're working on them, but then we think we're making progress. But this is that long line that goes on forever. The cat's still up in the tree. Here it comes. Okay. It's coming down now, finally. Wow. He just took a siesta up in a tree. Uh-oh. We don't want to be treed forever, do we? We do not want to be treed forever. What's it doing? Oh my gosh. It's walking on a very, very thin branch in the wind. That is crazy. Holy cow. Is a natural born climber. He is fearless up in trees. Unbelievable. So it's good to intersperse this with some asides like this, just to let it all kind of sink in and give us a feeling like, hey, it's no big deal to be talking about this. It's no big deal. You don't have to have some kind of power robes on in some arcane special place, some secret initiations, talking about all this stuff. No, we can just talk about this in the general flow of our lives and everything that's just happening around us. That's the whole point. We have to do that. We have to do it. We have to be always switching the emphasis here. So we've gone way further than we've ever had it before, right now. That is for sure. And it's just... that makes it easier for us. So we realize that there never was any chaos. That was actually... we did that to ourselves so we could believe that we can succeed, just that we can't see where the problem is to fix because of the chaos. Chaos is obscuring it. But then we could go to work on that chaos and start bit by bit by bit by bit by bit figuring it out where the problem is, figuring it out. But in reality, there never was any chaos at all, none. We never objectified reality. We never objectified. It's never been objectified. Reality has never been objectified. Therefore, there isn't any problem to solve at all. There isn't any problem to solve. And the more you see that, the more confidence you get out of that endless line of lies into the line of grace. This cat is doing a high wire act. Anyway, whatever. It's saying, hey, I got a problem. I'm up in a tree. But reality has never been objectified. The here-ness has never been objectified. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing we need to atone for. There is no sin. There is no guilt. We never did it. We never did it at all. This is what we've seen in this video now. We never did it. The chaos, again, was just another aspect of desire saying, even though I refuse to accept I can't do it, objectify it, what I'm going to do is saying I can do it, but there's something, a problem that I need to solve about doing it, and I can't tell what that problem is at all. And that's a nice excuse to put in front of the it's impossible to do. You know, it's a way of saying, it's impossible, but I desire to do it, therefore I'm going to look at it this way, as chaos. I never know what that cat is going to do next. It's like the world, you never know what the world's going to do next. Doesn't matter. There isn't any problem with reality. There's never been. We are not out of sorts with reality. We never lost our here-ness. Just because we thought we objectified reality and therefore we don't have a here-ness. We didn't. We did not. And just because we thought that we were working on a problem to solve that we can objectify, but is that we just have to work on this problem to solve it, and we think that that's what we're supposed to be doing, doesn't mean that our here-ness is affected at all. Hey, the cat made it down. That was quite an excursion. Quite an excursion. Wow. Hey. So nothing is wrong. Nothing is wrong with us. Nothing is wrong with reality. Nothing is wrong with our relationship with reality. Nothing is wrong with the here-ness at all. Nothing whatsoever. Nothing ever happened to it. That's why I say nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened at all. Nothing happened. And of course we have this massive system of problem making. How can you keep the charade of problem solving if you're not making problems? All the while thinking, well, this is how we're gradually working on this chaos, is putting some structure and form and organization and all this kind of stuff. And it's interesting because I don't have any desire to organize anything or structure anything or work on problems. I just simply don't have that. I say, what's why? For what? It's all useless. And so it makes people think I'm lazy or something. No. I realize it's useless. There's no point to it. Nothing is wrong with the here-ness. We never sinned. We never fell from grace. We never got out of sorts with reality. There isn't any problem whatsoever. There's nothing to fix about being. And there's just this massive dream that we've dreamed up. And so while we're in this dream, the grace will somehow keep us afloat in this dream, pretending in some ways maybe that we seem to have some situation, whatever. But we can be aware of the here-ness. We can be aware that there really isn't any problem at all. We can be aware of that even while we're here in this world, in this dream, while we're still working on problems, seemingly. And of course, the body's inherently seems problematic. How do I keep this body alive, right? This is the number one problem we all have. How do I keep this body alive? It seems like the most incredible, difficult problem. For me, it just seems, it's always been just incredibly difficult. How do I keep this body alive? Every second of every day, I'm thinking, you know what? I'm not doing good enough. It just isn't, I don't feel like I'm succeeding in keeping this body alive. Because the vulnerability is always there. But when you realize that there are no problems with here-ness at all, it somehow it changes the entire situation. The fear of death, of trying to keep stuff alive, you know, as a problem. The whole idea of that there's a problem, you know, is gone somehow. And it, you know, it's just amazing. It's really amazing. Fear disappears. Fear is gone. Fear is replaced with love. Miraculously, it seems like, right? Because we certainly say, how in the world can we ever be in a situation where we feel the body isn't threatened at all? Where we can actually experience love? How is that possible? You know, it seems impossible, doesn't it? And yet, somehow, by accepting there's never been anything wrong with the here-ness, you realize the total here-ness, there's never been anything wrong. So there isn't any reason to solve any problem whatsoever. And that's the real issue of it. See, we think that this body is for the purpose of developing technique to solve problems. And we realize there aren't any problems. The importance of the body is just, it seems to just vanish. The necessity of a body, the importance of a body, the purpose of a body. And we realize that failure is impossible. No such thing as failure. There are no problems. There's nothing to fix. So how can there be failure? Can't be failure. It's like that. And of course the flesh interprets this as, wow, how did you succeed? Didn't succeed. There is no need to succeed. In fact, it's impossible to succeed. There's no problem. If there's no problem, how can you succeed at fixing a problem? If everything's perfect, how can you talk about succeeding? I've gained success. I've succeeded. No, there's nothing to succeed at. Nothing to succeed at. Nothing to succeed at. We don't have to succeed. And so life then becomes one of loving instead of succeeding. Coming from love instead of fear. And that seems like a miracle, doesn't it, from where we're at? But I've experienced it several times. It's just a simple shift of attention, actually. From object, subject, objectivity, objectification to pure spaciousness. What's the relation of everything to pure spaciousness? Just the one here-ness, the one here-ness. And like a miracle, your whole situation is love-based instead of fear-based then. And It's just getting out of that line, the long line of lies and fear, into the line of grace. So we'll keep working at this. It's emphasis, emphasis, emphasis. Right emphasis, right emphasis, which means right attention, right attention. Where's your attention? Where's your attention? Can we shift it over to the idea of getting out of that line, that long line of lies and fear? Can we shift our attention over to the here-ness, the one here-ness, just the one here-ness, the one here-ness, the one here-ness, just the one here-ness, all in relation to pure spaciousness, all having the exact same relationship with pure spaciousness? We can never, it can never be lost in any way. No appearance can ever change that. So we're free to be formless, aren't we? We're free to be formless, because form doesn't alter pure spaciousness one bit. So ultimately, why do we even have to play with form? We don't really have to. Because form tends to lend itself to the whole scenario of problems and fixing and finding and all this stuff, right? But we, even with form, we can recognize the one relationship with pure spaciousness. Is easily doable. It's just a little shift of attention. And it seems as though I'm getting there as far as a willingness. Just like I was in that line today, I went through a process kind of getting there. Like, first the idea came up. Okay, what happened first was, hey, you know what? I have an account. I don't have to be in this line. That was the step one. And I said, oh. And I said, well, it's too late now. So let's go through what happened. It's too late now. I said, yeah, it's too late now. Yeah. Then I rationalized. I said, well, I don't mind waiting anyway, you know. I kind of feel like waiting. That's how I rationalized. I kind of feel like waiting in this line. It's kind of nice. And then I thought, yeah, but I get it done quicker if I went this way. And I should get it done quicker. I'm tired. I want to go home. And if I can find a way to do something quicker, why not? And so that's the second that came up like that. And then I said, well, yeah, I could do it, but maybe it won't work, rationalization. And I said, well, why, is there any reason why it wouldn't work? I don't know, why would they change their policy? See, so, and then I said, well, people will think I'm kind of like, why did I get in this line? I think I'm stupid. Why did I get in this line in the first place? Rationalization, they'll think I'm stupid. Yeah, because I've been waiting in this line for, you know, 15 minutes, and suddenly I pull out and go up there, and people are laughing, like, what an idiot. He could have gone up there and saved himself 15 minutes. Well, if they want to look at idiots, look at themselves. Everyone waiting in line, they can go and say, listen, do the same thing I did. They're waiting even longer if they want to use that. You know, that's really stupid. And so it's what happens is you get this glimmer of like, hey, why don't I do this? And then the rationalization says, no, that wouldn't be smart. That'd be foolish. And so you go back and forth. And gradually, I built up momentum saying, finally, I said, you know what? It's worth it to do this just to find out. Let's have the adventure anyway. Let's make an adventure. This is kind of like a cool thing to do. And I felt that way. It's like, yeah, I don't mind even if everyone laughs at me. This is kind of a cool thing to do, to suddenly pull out of a line and just drive past everybody. And I said, that's very adventurous. I like that. So I dared it. You know, I dared it. I risked it. And it worked out great. So this is the whole thing about the so-called spiritual, this ordeal of preparation we're on, is you'll make progress, and then rationalization will come up. The continuity fear is there, and you'll rationalize it. You say, no, wait a minute, that's just the continuity fear, wait a minute. It's really, you've got to be fine. And then you say, yeah, okay, yeah, but, and then another rationalization. And it goes between, ping-pongs between these rationalizations and reason. Reason and rationalization will go back and forth. But gradually, you get more and more resolve. Gradually, you get more and more resolve. This is what happens. And you just have to keep working at it. You know, reason is always willing to work at it. Again, it's entirely possible I'll pull out of the line in terms of, I'll pull out of the long line of duality, kingdom, you know, the economy of the flesh. I'll pull out of that line into the economy of grace. It's entirely possible I'll do that. You don't know it until you do it. It's entirely, but it is certainly, that's, it's emerging as I'm feeling more and more like, wow, that'd be a kind of a real cool thing to do. Now, of course, the one rationalization is, well, nobody else is doing it. There was nobody there. And I said, well, I'm going to wait until like some other trucks are doing that so I don't feel like such a fool if it doesn't work. I said, oh, well, they're dumb. They're fools too. But there's really nobody. You know, nobody was doing it. And I feel like right now in the world, there's so few who are really doing this, who are pulling out of the line saying, okay, this is it. I'm going to do it. And so if it doesn't work for me, I'll look like a real fool. You know, really. And yeah, nowhere to hide. Yeah, go back to the line. I'm just like the only one back there. And everyone else is laughing. Say, see, we're smarter than you are. We're smarter than you are. Whereas a bunch of others try it. And I do it at the same time, I say. And we all fail. It's like, well, hey, I'm not the only one that failed. So there's an additional difficulty in when nobody's doing it. But there's also like a pretty cool adventure of that too, you know. I'm trying to convince myself of that. Like, wow. That's a very intense adventure, isn't it? I'm interested in that. Yeah, why not? Why not? Because right now everybody's pretending like there is some problem. And to do this when everybody's pretending there's some problem is just a really a profound, showing how profound the Holy Spirit is actually. That the Holy Spirit was not bluffed at all by all of this. And people just say, whoa. Wow. May give them pause, you know, may give them all pause deep down and say like, hey, look, how could someone pull out like this and nobody else is pulling out? Like, wow. It's like that. And it may down the road give them enough pause to completely change their destiny path. Really. It may not seem that way right now. Probably won't. It probably will not show up at this time in many people here, as far as helping anyone. But deep down, the Holy Spirit tells us, yeah, it actually affects everybody. Anytime anyone pulls out of this line of lies and fear and futility to grace, everyone knows it and has a deep effect upon them. Even though on the surface it doesn't appear that way, but it plays out eventually by altering their destiny paths. So anybody that's saved actually has an effect on everybody else. This is what, so I think it's cool just to do that, even though, you know, it seems like it's such a risky thing. So I'm certainly considering it, I would say. I'm aware, I'm aware it's under consideration. That doesn't mean I'll do it. It doesn't mean it, because I've been under consideration my whole life, this under consideration. But it seems, the consideration seems to be very conscious. It's very much of a conscious consideration, which is better. It's rising to the surface, which is here, nowness, so to speak. Where I'm able to now look at it consciously instead of some deep dream state where, you know, it comes through in some dream, but then it's quickly forgotten. No, this is very, very much to the surface right now. It's very much on the surface. I tell you, nobody wants to go first, right? Everybody's sitting there waiting in line saying, what's going to happen to them? What's going to happen? Nobody pulled out behind me, actually. Nobody did. Nobody. Well, they probably didn't have commercial accounts technically, but nobody wants to go first, because if it fails, then everyone can sit back and say, look how smart I am. I didn't fall for that. I didn't fall for that trick. Look how smart I am. Wow. Today's like one of the first days I've had in a long time here, like this. The weather in California has been like darn near perfect for like, gosh, how long has it been? 2 years, or it's just been, it's so, you can hardly remember when it's been, when it's been this windy and stuff, because it's just been gentle and docile and beautiful in California just virtually every day for years now. And now we have the marine layer that's really coming hard, and there's a lot of, so much breeze that all the stuff from the trees is coming down, the dust is in the air, it's kind of glary, it kind of feels weird, it's kind of a weird feeling day, but, and it's so different than what we've had, which is just like, wow, what a beautiful day this is. Every day is like that. Of course, we've gotten into almost a state of no return with water here. Verging on that, I mean, because the groundwater, the aquifers are being pumped dry. They're being pumped dry. That can have problems, big problems down the road. We don't know exactly, really, what happens when all the aquifers are dry up, do we? Could they start collapsing? We start having earthquakes in California? Because ordinarily aquifers don't dry up. I mean, it's humans pumping from wells that are drying them up. It would take an extraordinary drought by itself to dry up all the underground aquifers, right? Because they're not subject to evaporation. So even if there's no rain filling them up, they might remain there, like a reservoir underwater. These huge underwater reservoirs don't necessarily go dry, even in droughts, I would think. Very slowly. But what we're doing is we're emptying the underground reservoirs, and as long as also the surface reservoirs and the underground reservoirs are being emptied dry. And it's going to take a heck of a lot of water to fill those up. It doesn't matter if we have a normal rainy season this year. That is not going to solve the problem at all. It would take like just a deluge of a rainy season to get things back to okay. And so if we just have a normal rainy season, then we have another long dry season, and we're still going to be in incredible trouble here. And so we need to have like, 4 or 5 rainy seasons in a row, good seasons in a row, or a couple of monsoon-like rainy seasons, and it's unlikely that will happen, actually. So we could be, in California, could be in an extraordinarily severe, bad situation. They should be building desalination plants like crazy here, actually. It's entirely possible the state's not going to go back to a good situation. That is possible. It really is. There's not a lot of desalination plants on, being built, which is incredible lack of foresight here in this state. Just unbelievable how our economy and the way we've been spending money and focusing on things. They're spending all this money on a bullet train from the Bay Area to Southern California. They should be spending that money on desalination plants, because this situation may not get better. Actually, it could just be an intractable problem going forward. See, welcome to the kingdom of the flesh. This is, perfect storms happen all the time. Civilization, if you look at history, if you're just smart, and you look at history with wisdom and the grace of the Holy Spirit, you have to say, wow, you cannot trust this world at all. It seems to be custom designed to bring about problems. Perfect storms seem to be by design. I ran into one of them today in driving. It caused me a problem in driving. It was just like, whoa. Everything conspired to to distract my attention, you know, is just amazing. And the whole planet is, history's always been that way. Civilizations have absolutely collapsed. Very noble, thriving, great civilizations have utterly collapsed, disappeared without a trace, as it were. Look at Egypt. Egypt, the great Egyptian civilization, was completely buried under sand. Nobody even knew it ever existed until the explorers started to rediscover, and Napoleon went down there and started rediscovering a lot. But up until then, through the Middle Ages, etc., nobody even knew that Egypt had ever existed. This incredible civilization that had been thousands and thousands and thousands of years, you know, these massive monuments and etc. Now, there was the pyramids, and people saw it, but nobody had any idea where they came from or what that was about or anything. The Sphinx, the pyramid. I think the Sphinx was buried, actually. The Sphinx was buried. And a lot of people say that the Egyptians came from the destruction of Atlantis, actually. And that had, you know, vanished without any hardly memories or traces. This planet has gone through an amazing amount of problems and troubles. And it seems custom designed to bring about problems and troubles. And that's exactly its design. That's exactly its design. So that we can get this feeling that we have problems. What frightens us the most is to feel like we don't have problems. That terrifies us, because we think then that we're going to be stuck with this utter chaos. Whereas if we have problems, at least one problem we're identifying, we'd say, oh, okay, at least I know where the problem is, and at least therefore I can work on it. I can locate it in time-space. I can work on it in duration. And that seems to calm our fears down. Whereas if we say, well, we don't have any problems at all, we think that that's going to, then we're going to be stuck with this picture of utter chaos. Like, where's the problem? I can't find the problem. I know it's there, I just can't find it. See? So we're terrified about not having any problems. So this world to us, we love the world. You know, people talk about how much they love the world, and I always say, are they crazy? What are they talking about? This is like the worst place ever. Now what they mean is they love the problems, because they feel without the problems, they would have this picture of utter chaos. Well, I would say no, because all you have to do is repent and say, no, I don't want to try and objectify totality. And then if you drop the desire to objectify totality, there's no need then to deny the fact that you can't do it. So this image of total chaos, this total chaos experience, doesn't arise at all. So you don't, then therefore you don't have to try and find a problem, a particular problem. Having a body in a world is a way of saying, hey, I got a problem. This is great. So people come in this world, they say, oh, this is just great. I just love it here. I love being a body in a world with problems, because it seems to protect them from something vastly worse, which is this picture, this experience of total chaos. But what we've seen here is that's just, again, a denial that we can't objectify reality. Is our denial of that. Therefore, we say, no, we can do it. It's just that we don't know how to do it, which then gives us this picture of total chaos, where we say, you see, we just can't find it. There's no way to discover where it is here, but let us work on it now through having individual problems, you see. So we have an individual body in this individual world. We have individual problems. That's how we pretend to be working on this picture of utter chaos, which is just our own denial that we can't do it. So there's no problem. There's no problem. We just can't do it. It's not doable. So there's no problem. So that's why people say they love this world. They love bodies. They love this world. That's why. Now I said, I hate bodies. I hate this world. It's ridiculous. I don't want any problems. I don't want any problems. Well, I must have wanted some, right? I wouldn't have come in here and had them. But by and large, largely, I say I don't feel like working on problems, really. I really don't feel like working on problems. Well, I've been working on the problem of why do we have problems, really, which is the right way to use your time. here. But I don't have this desire to suffer and have problems and categorize and sort and name and classify and structure and communicate and relate with other bodies and all these things, you know. This is, well, what's the point? There's no reason, no need for that. There's no need for it. There's no need for it whatsoever. None. No real need for any of this, actually. No real need for any of this, except the continuity fear. We need a soft landing back to realizing no needs at all. Soft landing into no needs. So we keep needs, but they come less and less and less and less. I don't need that so much. I don't need that so bad. Oh, I don't really need, you know, that much sickness. I don't need that much troubles. I don't need this. I don't need that. And gradually, I'll, you know, release all these needs. False needs, bogus needs. It's like the cat realized, I don't need to be a squirrel. It finally came down from the tree and says, that's enough of that. I don't need to be a squirrel. I can come down from the tree. It's tired of being up in that tree because the squirrels are just easy for them. But the cat says, wow, it's tough for me up here. And so the reason why we keep going on and taping is because it's all about familiarity with this new emphasis. That's what it's all about. You just have to put in the time and effort of getting familiar. Lose your comfort zone. And it becomes easier and easier for you. And you can just look at this stuff that's central to the whole situation. And you just look at it like, oh yeah, it's simple, it's pretty easy, there's no trouble. Yeah, I'm used to this. This is normal for me to be looking at this. It is. For me, it's just as normal as going in and eating dinner. That's it. Watching a baseball game, I'll go watch a baseball game. To this is just for me, it's the same. It's just normal. And so the solution should be normal. Oh, okay, outcome is, this is the outcome. Vision of oneness, total hearingness. Yeah, that's normal. That's a normal, that's the dessert, you know, ate the meal, here's the dessert, that's normal. So putting in the time is all important to get used to this emphasis. And of course, when we finish, then it will get switched back to the world of problems and saying, oh, I'm glad I have these problems I can work on. I've got all sorts of problems. My life has become super problematical as an alternative, of course, to not having problems. It seems like as you get closer and closer to deciding you don't need any problems, you also tend to draw problems to yourself. Like, wait a minute, if this doesn't work, I got to have something to shift back, you know, an alternative. And I'll need a lot of problems because you're thinking you might go back to chaos, you know, to attempt to objectify reality. And then realizing you can't do it, then denying you can't do it, saying I can, but I just have to figure out why I'm not able to. You think if you go back to that, then you really need to jump back to all these problems. So you need a life of like super problems. So that's sort of way my life has been, a life of super problems, because I've been trying to drop problems altogether. And there's like, I'm kind of like saying, well, boy, gotta have some safety net here just in case. Yeah, but things are getting so problematical now. I said, hey, I better take the risk, you know. I better take the risk now. Otherwise, it's going to be too late. Too late, too late, too late. All right. So this has given us a nice, robust effort here to spend time, which is what's necessary. We need a robust effort because it's familiarity. It's not intellect. It's familiarity. Trust me on this. It is familiarity. Because we're trying to get our nerve up, you see, we're trying to gather our nerve. So we have to be really familiar and gradually evaporate the continuity fear, evaporate the rationalizations. All these rationalizations we come up, that's the continuity fear. Then we look at these rationalizations and say, no, that's not really the problem at all. That's not true. And gradually the rationalizations get less and 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 less, like that. gradually they get less. And we have to work through all these rationalizations are just one continuity fear, actually. So we can look at it that way. Everybody will have different rationalizations in various ways. And say, I can't do it because of this. I can't do it because of this. Now, first I have to fix this problem I'm working on. Remember, what we're going towards realization, we don't have any problem. We never did. That was our way of saying, yes, we can objectify reality. It's just we have a problem doing it. And we're going to realizing, no, we can objectify it, therefore we don't have any problem. Except the continuity problem. Right? Except the continuity problem now, because we've been believing we have a problem for so long, it's hard to drop, hard to accept we don't have any problems whatsoever, and then just abide in that. We're afraid of that. So, we have this continuity problem. So what will happen is, it will still seem that we at least have the potential for problems, somehow. Vaguely, you might have some vague feeling like, well, you know, it's still sort of like a faint, you know, trace or memory of problems or something. It'll be a soft landing for sure. That's the whole point, a soft landing into recognizing this. We've never had any problem. There's never been the slightest problem with reality whatsoever. Never. Never will be. And here we are valuing problems as if it's the ultimate value, because we think it protects us from total chaos. That's how we've been seeing it. So we value problems above all else, for sure. Why else would we have a body? Body is nothing but the fact to show that we value problems. That's all that it is. We value problems. Everybody with a body in this world, with exception of those who drop, you know, who now in a state of grace, they have the body because they value problems as a solution to chaos. That's it. And the Holy Spirit it explains to us, you know, reasons what it shows us what's really going on. What's really going on is that we wanted to cling to the belief we could objectify reality. Not being able to, we insisted it was only that we couldn't figure out how to do it, that there was a problem doing it. You see that? All right. Very great. Thanks for watching. This has been a tremendous experience, and we'll see what comes of this. That's it.